This right here is the Fujifilm X-H2, and if you're a photographer, you want to know about this camera. Let's have a chat about it.
Fujifilm surprised a lot of people with not one, but two X-H2s this year. The X-H2S, which I reviewed earlier this year, is built for speed. With its 26 megapixel stacked sensor, it's able to take photos up to 40 frames per second and has some of the fastest autofocus ever seen in a Fujifilm. The X-H2, on the other hand, puts a greater emphasis on resolution with a 40.2 megapixel sensor and the ability to shoot 8K video.
With the body and firmware of both of the X-H2s basically being exactly the same, there's not really much more I need to say about the design of this. I get pretty passionate when I'm talking about this in my X-H2S review, so go back and watch that.
Fix this camera.
You'll quickly understand why I don't like the change to a single PASM dial and why so many functions have been turned into button presses.
It's very frustrating. But there's also a lot to love with this design. It's still just my absolute favorite camera to hold. Like, it actually excites me to pull it out of my bag and start taking snaps on the street. The main draw of this camera is its massive 40.2 megapixel sensor, which is actually the biggest sensor on a crop camera ever made, just beating out the Canon's R7, which is at 32.5 megapixels, and that also came out at about the same time as this, so sorry about that, Canon.
Here are some photos I took in my travels over the past couple of weeks, and really, I'm just blown away by how gorgeous these images are with very little effort on my end in post. It certainly helps that most of the time I had it paired with Fujifilm's excellent new 56mm f1.2 prime lens. That aperture, of course, allows you to take really soft, shallow depth of field photos in even the darkest of places, but even the X-H2 itself excels in low light. The inbuilt image stabilization allows you to shoot at pretty low shutter speeds, even if you're just holding it in your hand. I found 1/30 was totally fine. And the ISO is quite impressive on this as well. You can pretty much push it to 6400 or so before you start to see artifacts that actually impact the quality of the image.
The X-H2 lineup clearly comes with a lot of little inspirations from Fujifilm's GFX lineup, which is their massive megapixel medium format cameras. This one actually gets a drive mode from those, which is pixel shift, which basically uses the IBIS, the thing that stabilizes the sensor, to slowly just tilt around a little bit to take 20 separate photos at slightly different angles. Then you can go into some software and stitch them all together and get a 160 megapixel photo.
I, of course, wanted to give this a crack and thought a high angle of the Melbourne cityscape would be a great way to capture lots of detail. It'll take 20 photos in about 10 seconds if you've got it on the highest setting. But you can't look at your photo, you have to take it into some special desktop software to stitch all the images together. But there's a huge problem. Where are the people? What is going on with these cars? Yeah, because it's taking these photos over a period of time, it's kind of like leaving the shutter speed really slow. Things blur, disappear completely, or you get these weird colored artifacts going on. It fares quite a bit better on things that aren't moving, like this office building. And if we zoom into this, you can see just how much extra detail this process can capture.
It's certainly not a feature you're going to be using all that much, perhaps ever, but if you want to experiment with really high megapixel images on stuff that isn't moving, it's definitely there for you, and I found it a lot of fun. I would probably practice that if I had this camera for longer.
If you need 8K video up to 30fps, this is now one of the cheapest ways to get high quality 8K from a mirrorless camera.
I was worried there might be a few compromises with 8K on this camera, but nope, it works perfectly. It looks as good as ever, and that is the full sensor at work, no cropping in.
If you don't need all that resolution, you can still make use of the big sensor by using 4K HQ mode, which oversamples from 8K. And I was happy with all the footage that came out of that mode as well.
The question that arises now is, do I buy the X-H2 or do I buy the X-H2S? Both are really good cameras, but it's not exactly like the iPhone 14 where the Pro is clearly the better choice. It's just a bit more expensive. The S and the X-H2 kind of do different things. Unfortunately, I kind of had them a couple of months apart, so I haven't been able to do comparisons of these, but I've watched a bunch of other YouTubers talk about this sort of stuff, and they've all kind of come to the same conclusion.
While it doesn't get 8K, the XH2S and its stacked sensor excels in video as well as sports or event photography. Meanwhile, the XH2, thanks to its massive 40.2 megapixel sensor, is the favorite for other forms of photography.
If you do want to dive into the finer details between the two cameras, I've left a bunch of links down in the description to the videos that I really liked and got a lot out of.
Check those out if you really want to pixel peep the differences between these two very similar cameras.
So is the X-H2 worth it at all? For photographers, I think yes, absolutely, you will love this camera. The higher megapixel count than what we're used to on normal Fujifilm crop sensors really just elevates what you can get out of their glass. And personally, I was just excited to shoot on this because I finally had access to really high megapixel photos that you just don't really get on crop sensors. And while the X-H2S is still considered the better camera of the two when it comes to videography, this is still an amazing video camera. You've got the ports on the side, it does up to 8K. Like, it's a Fujifilm camera, so it looks really nice. The autofocus on this, while not as good as the X-H2S, is still a huge improvement over the X-T4. Yeah, like, if you want to save $500 and don't mind not picking the optimal choice, this is still a really good video camera as well. Personally, while I had a really good time shooting on this,
it's tough to commit to buying one of these when the X-T5 has just been announced. That seems to take almost everything that makes this camera so good, but gives us back the tactile dials and switches that I so dearly missed.
But don't let me stop you. If you're coming from something like Canon or Sony, you might be right at home with a design just like this. But for me, you can't beat those Fujifilm dials. Anyway, that's it. Hit subscribe so you're notified when my X-T5 review comes out, because I'll definitely be doing that one. And if you haven't watched it already, watch my X-H2S review, where I go into a bit more detail as to why I don't like the design of these that much. It's a bit of a rant, but it's a passionate one. So if you like passion and you like cameras, go check that video out.